Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship. Yet again, it has been a week, huh? I am so thankful that we have each other, that we have this space and this time to be together, that we have God's word to ground us and bring us to focus about who we are and what we're doing with our lives and what matters in life. So very, very grateful that we have this community of faith to help us to be the best of who we can be and to have a place to go when we have been the worst of who we can be and know that the love and grace of God is there to receive us. So a hearty welcome to all. Glad that you are here. And let's take a moment to quiet ourselves, to center ourselves in this space, to remind ourselves what it means to be embraced by the love of God and to have the opportunity to be in worship of God together. So we'll take a moment of quiet and listen to our call to worship. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Here in this place, the new light is streaming. Now is the darkness vanished away. See in this face our fears and our dreamings, brought here to you in the light of this day. Gather us in the lost and forsaken, gather us in the blind and the lame. Call to us now and we shall awaken, we shall arise at the sound of our name. We are the old who yearn for your face. We have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Gather us in the rich and the haughty, gather us in the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so meek and so lowly, give us the courage to enter the song. Here we will take the wine and the water, here we will take the bread of new birth. Here you shall call your sons and your daughters, call us anew to be salt for the earth. Give us to drink the wine of compassion, give us to eat the bread that is you. Nourish us well and teach us to fashion lives that are holy and hearts that are true. Not in the dark of buildings confining, not in some heaven like years away. Here in this place a new light is shining, now is the kingdom and now is the day. Gather us in and hold us forever, gather us in, all peoples together, fire of love in our flesh and our bones.
Let us pray. We give you thanks today, living God, that you know us and the needs of all your creatures. And still your love persists in every circumstance. We gather together before you in complicated days, trusting in your presence with us. We seek your face in order to be transformed and strengthened to face the wreckage of disease, despair, violence, and dishonesty. Draw us close to you. Unleash your Spirit's power to restore, heal, and awaken your world. Begin a new day in us all.
Amen.
Okay, kids, it's time for Children's Chat with Camp.
Hey, Alana.
Hey, Taylor.
What's going on?
Not much.
Because you're kind of staring at me.
Well, yeah, I was just kind of thinking about the first time that we met and how I kind of just knew we're going to be friends. And that you were just someone that I could probably click with and that you could be someone I could share life with and somebody that I could just truly trust.
Wow, you know what? I felt the same exact way, too, when we met. And I'm pretty sure that Jesus feels that way when he met his friends, you know? I'm pretty sure there's a story in the Bible where Jesus is just walking, and he meets this guy named Philip, and he says, you know what? Come along with me.
Wow, and what did Philip do?
Well, Philip said, well, sure, and I'm going to invite my friends, too.
But they didn't even know him.
Oh, I think they did. I think they felt the same way about each other as when we met each other. You know what I mean? I think when they saw Jesus, they were like, that's somebody I want to hang out with. And when Jesus saw them, he said, well, I just think that these people are just know how to spread God's love and teach it to others.
Wow, but they're kind of just ordinary people. How did Jesus know they could do extraordinary things?
Well, Jesus is like God, and he can see and he knows what's in our hearts. And you know what God sees when he sees our hearts?
No, what?
Well, he sees of how beautiful people we are and all of the amazing things that we can do. And you know, just wouldn't you want to be around someone who believed in you and loved you for who you were?
I sure would. I would love to be around that. And I also think that we should spread God's love with each other too, and you at home can do that. Remember that God sees what's truly in our hearts, and let's spread that message to others. So if you would please pray with us. Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for seeing what's truly in our hearts. Thank you for loving us for who we are. Thank you for allowing us to be surrounded by people who also share that love and allow us and give us the strength to share your love with everyone else. And in your name we pray,
amen. Amen.
The first lesson today is from the third chapter of 1 Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his rooms. The lamps of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, Samuel, Samuel. And he said, here I am, and ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you have called me. But he said, I did not call, lie down again. So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call, my son, lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, see, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I had told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever. Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli, but Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is from Psalm 139. Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it all together. You encompass me behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. For you yourself created my innermost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body was not hidden from you while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. My days were fashioned before they came to be. How deep I find your thoughts, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours. The second lesson is from the sixth chapter of 1 Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food. And God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh. But anyone united to the Lord becomes one with him, one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not on your own? For you were brought with a price. You were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Open your ears, O faithful people. Open your ears and hear God's word. Open your hearts, O royal priesthood. God has come to you.
A reading from the Gospel of John, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And Jesus answered him, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Would you pray with me, please? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So I want you to say a word with me. Hineni. Hineni. Go ahead, try it.
Hineni.
Hineni.
Hineni. It's a Hebrew word that we will all come to know well by the end of this sermon. It's one of those words that encompasses so much more than a singular meaning, like the Hebrew word shalom or hesed, or the Hawaiian word ohana. When God called upon Abraham to sacrifice his son, Abraham's response was, "Hineni." And when the angel later rushed to stop Abraham from performing that unthinkable act, Abraham once again answered, "Hineni." When Moses stood before the burning bush and heard his name called out, he responded, "Hineni." And when little Samuel kept hearing the voice of God, but thinking it was his mentor, Eli, he learned the only response a prophet makes. "Hineni, here I am, Lord. Here I am. Here I am, ready and able to do what you ask of me. Here I am, fully present for the work you set before me. Here I am, 100% willing to go the distance, whatever it is you ask of me. Here I am, Lord. I'm yours. I'm listening. I'm ready." When the High Holy Days begin in the fall for our Jewish brothers and sisters, the cantor opens with a prayer for God's help to even begin to know how to lead the people in prayer. And it begins with the word "Hineni." It reminds both God and the people that the cantor themselves are flawed, that as a leader, they are flawed, and they need God's help to even begin to invite them into the right space to lead the people, much less encourage the people to be 100% ready to accept responsibility for their deeds and misdeeds, and to prepare them for the step of transformation that repentance will bring. Essentially saying, "Here we are, all of us, Lord, and we need you." Whenever a character in the Bible, especially in the Hebrew scriptures, is responding to the call of God, is about to embark on or live into a moment of profound change or crisis or transformation. Hineni is the response. Here I am to God. And it comes with the solemnness of a spiritual soldier, so to speak, reporting for perilous duty, but faithful service. It's not here as in when someone's taking role and we just say that we're present. It's not showing up just physically. It's more of an existential expression, a response that's also a statement and a commitment and a call to action. It's saying spiritually, I'm all in. I'm prepared to reflect on who I am and bring all of me to whatever the task is that God is asking. One of the beautiful things about that response is that inherent in it is the understanding that we are undoubtedly inadequate to the task, but still we are saying to God, count me in nevertheless. You can make up the difference. Being a human being and being flawed is not an excuse for not responding to God's call. It's how we respond, warts and all. We humbly acknowledge our limits and move forward saying Hineni to God. We are living in a moment in time when God keeps calling our names, trying to get our attention. And sometimes, like Samuel, we run to the wrong places and look in the wrong places for direction. We're living at a moment in time when God keeps calling us by name, trying to wake us up little by little as we learn to recognize, like Samuel did, what the voice of God is and is not, what it sounds like, what it feels like to listen to God. We are living at a moment in time when what we hear whispered into our ears by the Holy Spirit may not be popular. It may not be comfortable socially to speak out loud. And it is the prophets who remind us to tell the truth about who God is and what God cares about, even when it's hard, especially when it's hard. Through all the noise and disruption and chaos of the days that we have been living for quite some time now, God is nudging us out of our sleep, calling us by name, each of us individually and all of us together, to speak the truth when we see the face of evil, when what is going on around us tears down what God has created and named as good, when the most vulnerable among us are trampled, when all people are not created equally, are not treated equally and treated as valued siblings in the family of God, when the truth becomes a rhetorical play toy, God is calling us, looking to us to be exactly what the mission is that we have named as a community, to be God's love, justice, and hope in the world. Last week, we saw on full display how deeply held the racism is in our country, the anti-Semitism, the misogyny, the hatred that is randomly passed out. Is it a minority? Yes, of course, but not an impotent minority. A cancerous tumor in our bodies might only be an inch long, but it makes the whole body very sick. Five families are grieving the loss of a loved one today, with dozens more who will be trying to recover from their injuries and from the traumas associated with them for a good long while. God is nudging us out of our dream state and forcing our eyes to adjust to the light that is making clear to us the reality before us. Every time someone takes to a microphone and distorts the truth, denies the value of a single person, points to someone else for the cause of their misdeeds, God is calling our names and listening for our response. When God taps us on the shoulder and says, "I need you to speak up. I need you to call your elected leaders. I need you to hold people accountable. I need you to help put an end to the violence." The question before us is, what is our response? Is it "Hineni"? Here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. You need your ways shown like a light in the darkness. I'm your person. I'm your human flashlight. I'm here. I'm listening. I'm ready to act. Hineni. It doesn't matter whether we're children like Samuel or a preacher like Martin Luther King Jr. or a senator or a congressional rep. It doesn't matter if we're younger or older, richer or poorer. What matters is when we look into the face of evil and God asks us to do God's work there, what is our response? In so many ways, in our culture, we've been conditioned to think of being a Christian as someone who shows up on Sunday morning, attends church. But an answer to this kind of question says, "I'm busy. My plate is very full. I think I'll leave that to the activists or to the people getting paid to deal with this sort of thing." We've been so enculturated to respond here as if someone is taking attendance instead of "Hineni, here I am, Lord. Whatever you need." Another challenging reality of the response of "Hineni" is an awareness that the task before us will not be easy. It will call out of us something more than we think we have to give. And it will be transformational. Every Old Testament personality who responded "Hineni" was transformed, was changed. We will be changed in the process when we respond to God with our whole heart. It's hard work. And with events that have been going on in the last year or so, remind us how critical it is that Christians, people who are truly following Jesus, show up for that work. When God taps us on the shoulder and says, "I need you to love your enemies. I need you to spend time learning how radicalized people find a way out of the mob mentality. I need you to think about what kind of public language invites growth and builds bridges and shows love like I would. I need you to find a place of compassion in yourself for the people who are drunk on the illusion of power over others. And I need you, people of God, to love them in a way that gives them a reason to want to change and a place to belong. What do you say? Hineni? Here I am, Lord. It's hard. God has set an alarm clock, and we have been shaken awake by the events that have taken place around us, not just last week, Lord knows last week, but not just last week, all of last year. And if we think about it carefully, there have probably been times when God's been at work trying to get our attention over the course of seasons of our lives in one way or another. Because God is always actively at work trying to get our attention and calling us to bring light to the shadowy, broken places in our world. But boy, the heat has been turned up on it of late. And it is so critical that we understand what kind of a conscious response we are making, not just trying to plan our days to get through hard things, but really listening to God, hearing what God is asking of us, the little things and the big things. When Jesus called Nathanael to follow him, Nathanael had his doubts, his cynicism. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? He was quick-witted, but not convinced, until he was, in the quietest of ways, shaken awake to the reality that Jesus knew him, not just saw him, not just counted him among the group, but understood him, knew all of who he was. And this Jesus, who had the power to reach out and see him and know him and love him, was inviting him to work alongside him. And in that moment of that encounter with Jesus, Nathanael is overwhelmed. He's changed. He understood who Jesus is. And he experienced the power of Jesus loving him and needing him to work shoulder to shoulder with him. And his response was the Greek version of Hineni. You are the Son of God. I get it. You're the chosen one of Israel. Here I am, Lord. And he took the first step of becoming a candle in the darkness to serving Jesus, not just admiring him or questioning him from a distance, but walking alongside him and making his priorities his priorities. God is calling us today to do the same. How will we respond? Hineni, here I am, Lord. We are here, God. We're listening. We're ready to act in your name for the healing of the world. Put us to work. And let each of us pray, Hineni. Amen.
prisoner free and never be the same. Will you kiss the leopard queen and do such as this on sea and admit to what I need in you and do in me? Will you love the you?
Guided by Christ's example in prayer, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need.
For the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, and for all servants of the gospel, that following Jesus, the people of God would eschew all violence and greed and live out their calling every day, let us pray. Have mercy, O God.
Mercy, O God.
For the well-being of creation, for plants and animals, and for all that God has marvelously made, that we serve as wise stewards of earth, our home, let us pray. Have mercy,
O God.
For police officers and firefighters, for attorneys and paralegals, for peacekeepers and military personnel, and for the leaders of governments, that they provide protection to all people, especially the most vulnerable. Lord, we stand in prayer with a grieving nation and ask for your comfort to sustain the families of the police officers who died as a result of last week's violent attack on the Capitol building. Be with Officer Brian Sicknick's family and the family of Officer Howard Liebengood, both suffering profoundly. Be with the families of Roseanne Boyland, Ashley Babbitt, Benjamin Phillips, and Kevin Gleason, all of whom died related to the rioting. We pray for every one of the nations of the world and their leaders, that wisdom and honorable governance might prevail. We pray also for laborers around the world, busy both day and night, and for peacemakers amid strife. Protect all those in harm's way and those risking danger for the sake of others, including Zachariah Rollins. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those lacking food or shelter, for those who are sick or grieving, and for those who are imprisoned or homebound. Heal those who are sick or hurting, especially all dealing with the COVID-19 virus. We pray especially for Melinda Kay and her co-workers facing exposure to COVID-19 at work, Jen and Paul Bunnell, Dr. Kenyita Berryhill, Linda Sands, their families, and all who serve behind the scenes in caring for the sick and injured. We pray for Christy and John Magnuson's daughter and son-in-law, Kirsten and Shane, as they deal with the impact of COVID-19 on their jobs. For those currently fighting COVID-19, Mike Metzger and husband Dwayne and Jill Briggs. Guide all World Health Organizations and governmental officials in the distribution of the vaccines and calm the fears of those who are reluctant to receive the vaccine. Bring healing to baby Isaac's head shunt and to young Tristan Collins fighting cancer. That God console all who suffer. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
for the congregation gathered here, for students returning to school, for those seeking renewal in their daily work. We thank you for the continued healing of Ethel Swanson's nephew, David Russ. We continue to pray for complete healing for Marianne Hausner, for Jerry Mosthagen, and for Jackie Cullum. We prayed for continued healing for Carrie Leanhard, for Larry and Sue, for their friends Jeff and Sue Goddard, and their friend Kurt Kroshauer and family. We seek your wisdom and healing for Rosemary Capodici and Carol Kane. We pray that you make a way for approval for Karen's special juvenile immigrant status, restore and the lives of all who have found safety in the U.S. and are seeking asylum. We give thanks and celebrate with the Larson family as they rejoice in the news of the gift of daughter and sister for Kiel, Freddie, and Argo. May Brittany be healthy and strong during this sacred season of pregnancy. We also thank you for the improvement of Joy Wenzel's friend John Elkin, and for your sustaining grace for Connie and Marge and Bob Hood, and for Margaret and Roy. And we name before you now others for whom we pray.
For Rachel and for Wendy in the hospital.
Have mercy, O God. For our neighborhood, for visitors joining us for the first time or returning, and for those absent from our assembly, that all who seek to know God are nourished by word and sacrament, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the saints who have gone before us, the renewers of the church, that their lives give us a vision of the gospel in action, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a word of God's peace with one another and an image of peace.
Peace to everyone.
Be with you.
Peace to everyone.
Be safe. Peace, everyone.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Thank you for that showering of peace that we all enjoy every week. And thank you for the ways that you have showered your faithfulness and your gifts, and with regular attention to supporting financially the congregation, as well as in your prayers and time and effort and service. Thank you to everyone. You will, if you haven't already, receive your year-end giving statements. They went out in the mail this week. So if you have any questions about that, Joy Wenzel is the person to contact. Her number's in the statement itself. But thank you so much for all of the ways that you have been so incredibly intentional and faithful about supporting St. Luke throughout such a challenging year last year and moving into this year. We have been able to not only maintain our own staff and our own ministries, but help to take care of those people who have been far more devastated than we have. And that is because of your generosity and your faithfulness. And so I thank you again for that. Let us pray.
Oh God, receive these gifts as you receive us, like a mother receives her child with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen.
Amen.
So I invite you, if you haven't already, to get the elements for your participation in your communion meal close by. It is such a blessing that we can receive the presence of God being together and connected in the ways that we are. I'm just so thankful for that. And I hope that even though this feels different still than what you've been used to your whole life, I hope that in this moment in time, that you will have that sense of connection with the body of Christ that you would have whether we were in person or not, because the grace and power of God is among and between and within us. It is not in a building, it's not in a pew, it's not on a dais, it is between and among us. We've all grown up, I'm sure, being taught that the church is not a building, and it is in this moment that that is most profoundly true. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, gracious God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, the light of the world. In Jesus, we glimpse your face and receive your faithful care. We sing with choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, and we praise your name and join their unending hymn by saying, Holy,
holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy one,
God of all that is.
Heaven and earth are filled with your glory.
Hosanna in the highest heaven.
On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to God for it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the supper, he took the cup, again gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to his friends, saying, Take and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ will come again.
Amen.
We commune one another. The bread of life given for you.
The bread of life given for you.
The cup of salvation given for you.
The cup of salvation given for you.
We are one body in this
invite you to unmute yourselves as we share together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be
your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us
today our
daily bread.
Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from time to trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. We sing our sending song.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear to them, whom shall I say? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go.
Go in peace. Prepare the way of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will.
My name Jesus Christ, and He lives in me constantly. Makes me want to jump, makes me want to shout, woohoo! He really knocks me out of the rain.
this is my most favorite song ever.
Oh, baby, that's what I like.
Aww. Let's go faster.
Yeah!
If I sit here long enough, they'll give me bacon. To teach you the doggy hand motions? They're very easy. Smells like bacon again. Oh no, you hit me. That's okay. I forgive you.
Let's set the world record for speed.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Alright.
Time for my solo. Woo! Mark, Mark, bacon is delicious. Jesus and bacon.
We have to have that dog in the choir.
On that note, go in peace, serve the Lord, do or don't eat.
Thanks be to God.